Hello. For the generation of my parents, Europe had the name Europe had a very positive, almost magical ring to it. The generation that endured the war, Europe meant stability, reunification, peace, and all that kind of things. It seems now that the name of Europe evokes only negative emotions. Europe is Brussels. Brussels means bureaucracy. Brussels means the people that rob and steal our money and give it to unknown purposes. Europe seems to have become a dreadful concept, and a concept, something that we would rather shy, would run from. Well, tonight's speaker is going to give another vision of Europe, a much more positive vision, a vision of Europe as a new republic, a republic that gives its rights back to its inhabitants, that builds new institutions and a new future for a reunified Europe for citizens rather than for sovereign states. The speaker of tonight is Professor Dr. Ulrike Gero, and she is not only the writer of this wonderful book, which you can buy after the lecture, preferably, and which you can have signed by her as well, also preferably after the lecture, Red Europa in Dutch. But besides that, she is a professor at the Donau-Universität Krems and Danube University in Krems, Austria, head of the Department for European Policy and the Study of Democracy. She's the founder director of the European Democracy Lab in Berlin, which is a kind of European think tank, action group also a little bit. She served in a previous life, one of her many previous lives, I have to say, as director of the European Council on Foreign Relations. And she lectured at various renowned universities in Hamburg, Johns Hopkins University in America, INSEAD in Singapore, and many, many other. So we're very, very honored and pleased that tonight she will share her positive vision of Europe with us. As I said, after the lecture, which will stop at 9, so there will be a round of questions, and you can also ask your questions after the lecture, and after that there will be a signing session in the corridor. So can I invite you, Ulrike Gero, to give your lecture.
Yeah, so it's my pleasure to be to Nijmegen. I coming here because indeed the publishing house invited me to do a tour through the Netherlands, and I accepted. So I'm very happy to do 5 days in total, many Dutch towns. I started off in Maastricht yesterday, I will end in Amsterdam. And yesterday, when basically walking on the stage like here, I remembered a thing which I had forgotten, but which I will retell because it's an important story, I think. It was in spring 94, and I was just a young 27-year-old assistant of, by then, Wolfgang Schäuble, who by then was the head of the group of CDU in the German Bundestag, and I was his young assistant, was actually my first job. And as you know, the Maastricht Treaty has been signed in 92, and the CDU decided to write a paper about what should happen with Europe after the signature of ever closer union, the treaty, and they started to write a paper. In the process of this paper, there were one man who from which the group wanted advice, and it was Max Kronstamm. And by then, I wouldn't know who he is, and because Mr. Lamers and Mr. Schäuble hadn't time, I was sent as a very young 27-year-old to that meeting with Max Kronstamm. And I remember that I was put in a train, and the meeting took in French or English, whatever. Max Kronstamm picked me up at a train station in the Ardennen somewhere, I can't remember where, with a very old car. And we had something of an hour and a half ride to go there. And you imagine he was close to 80 and driving, and he would go, Europe is really important. And, you know, when I spoke to Stalin, and then I went to see de Gaulle, and Adenauer was against, and I felt like, what? And then I realized only afterwards that it was true, that he actually did that thing. And he was sticking together Europe in the one person thing. And I remember that well because the meeting took place again in spring 94. I had just given birth to my second son, and in the room of his house in the Ardennen, there was how do you call that, a broderie, like cross sticking, yeah, like you did with the dates of birth. And it was 22nd May 1914 for the birth of Max Kronstamm, and my son was born 22nd May 93. So I remember this, yeah. And it felt to me like yesterday when I was walking into Maastricht that this Europe we are talking about has a huge history. There were so many people engaged, people like Max Kronstamm, he was advisor to Jean Monnet, who in a single person basically did a tremendous job to bring that process of unification to where we are here now, basically where we are now at the moment of perhaps losing it all. Yeah, and so I'm very thankful to speak to you as Dutch. And perhaps the little other anecdote I should say, if I'm now basically trying to sell you the European Republic, this is not an affront to the House of Oranje. I happen to know Mabel von Oranje. I sent her the book and she was just fine. So just to put this here. So, but now Europe is in a crisis and in a very deep crisis. And I guess everybody is sensing and feeling this. Perhaps the reason for the crisis is this. And the deconstruction of the world tells you that we are going back to many national discourses. The nation, the nation, the nation is everywhere, but perhaps the nation is a hallucination, because what is a nation? By the way, I borrowed this from an Babi Badalov, is a Moldavian artist living in Paris. And he did also this crisis. We cry about a crisis, crying about a crisis, and we don't even know what is the crisis. Populism, nationalism, austerity, democracy, well, what is the crisis we are in? So, and it might have something to do with this and with this, because you remember that in 2012 the European flag was burned and we had Attac and Stefan Essel, Empört Euch, and much of revolt, ECB, 10 years. And it was a very, very bad moment to go through, especially for young people, because if I was talking from Max Kronstamm, who came from this after World War II period and built the Europe out of the peace paradigm, obviously the today's paradigm is a joblessness paradigm for the young people who don't feel the social peace accepted in Europe and so on and so forth. So Europe was or is really under strain, and it has perhaps much to do with this flag. So after working for, it's a very interesting sort of personal story, because I'm, you know, in one part of my brain, I try to reflect what happened to Mr. Schäuble between the moment of 94 and the day we are in, yeah, because the man who would essentially do the Varoufakis, this is a scoop thing in 2015, was not the man I had known when I was younger. Yeah? Because by then, in 94, the CDU was a perfectly pro-European party. And I remember, by the way, that we had many, many meetings with the by then Dutch CDA. And there was a guy who was a deputy of the Dutch parliament, Joost van Eersel, who is still around, who was a good friend. And all these people were so European and would evidently write in the Schäuble-Lamers paper, which was published on 1st of September 94, that obviously Europe, because now we are entering a monetary union, will need full fiscal, social and budgetary unity. You can read this in 94 as a statement of basically most of the political class. And 27 years later, if you say this, you are close to Varoufakis, fancy, progressive, utopian, sort of. So that is how the system shifted. But let's go back to what we are experiencing. After I had the enormous chance to work for Jacques Delors in the midst of the 90s, and Delors always had this sentence, you cannot fall in love with the single market. And I think for those who would know Delors, who was the first big president of the European Commission between 85 and 95, Delors was two things. He was a trade unionist and he was a Catholic. And these were really the driving forces behind him. And he was always upset that sort of with the Maastricht Treaty, we went monetary union and forget about the social union, which was the social protocol of 89. Margaret Thatcher stepped out. So the single market was not it for him. And for those who are old enough, you remember that in the 90s we had huge discussion about Maastricht Treaty, which was ever closer union, ever closer union. And ever closer union is basically still our constitutional legal basis as of today. In the German Grundgesetz, in the Dutch legislation, ever closer union, as long as we have signed this sort of treaty, which is still valid, we are all under the paradigm of ever closer union, just that we are not doing it. And we lost the aim, we lost the ambition for the political project of Europe. And that's basically what I'm trying to talk about this evening, because just the single market, it's just not enough, because then people go, look, I mean, do we want to harmonize the oil on the tables in restaurants or whatever, the tractor seats, the apples, you know, and there's a real problem. A French friend told me, en France, on meurt pas pour la démocratie. En France, on meurt pour la République. And so here I am with the Republic, because what we did with the Maastricht Treaty is essentially, to quote Jürgen Habermas, that we disentangled state and market. We put markets, we put markets and the single market and European currency on the European level, and we kept social distribution, fiscal policies on the national level. So basically, we disentangled the levels between state and market. And independently on whether you are more with Hayek or more with Marx, left or right, state and market need to be on the same level and need to be connected. So the moment we did the Maastricht Treaty, we basically did the market and then the currency, but we never did the last bit of the piece, which is that so-called political union, or it was once called political union, and we have given up on this intention. So much of the little sort of 25 minutes performance I want to do here is, if there's one slogan, it's one market, one currency, one democracy. And I think we should go for completion. We should go for completion of that one market and that one currency, which is an all-fine currency, a currency without parents, so to say. And that currency should be embedded into one democracy. Why? Because a currency is a social contract. A currency is already a social contract. And so the moment what we have experienced in the past 10 years, the European crisis, was basically that we could not solve a political crisis. And that is why we turned it into a chauvinist crisis. We didn't have the policies to decide in common about where to spend the money, who was the victim of the crisis, who should be helped and who should be not. But whoever lost in the crisis and whoever benefited from the crisis, it was by no means a national distinction. The Greek harbor worker suffered from the euro crisis as much as the cleaning woman in Germany, and the Greek ship owner benefited from the crisis as much as somebody from Deutsche Bank. So the problem was that we had a problem between capital and labor, young and old, center, periphery, but we had no way, no system to discuss it like this. But we needed to go with blame games, sort of the heavy working Germans against the lazy Greeks and the Italians who can't do tax paying and the French who cannot do reforms, to just mobilize some of the cliches, with the little footnote that the Dutch were not really a big voice in that blame game, but you had a good sort of attitude to always hide behind Germany. Like Austria. Like Finland, like. So that's why I think we need to reanimate the discussion of political union, but with different terminology. Because political union seems to be something which is not working, or federalism, or United States of Europe, and so. So why did I came up with the Republic? To be honest, it was by full, whatever. I tell you the story, perhaps it's worse, like, how did I find it, yeah? And it was not because of research. I was in April 2012, in the midst of the Cypriot bailout. I was in Brussels, and there was a morning, Monday morning after the EU Council, where the European Union seemed dead, as can be something dead, because the system didn't function and so. And it was really my moment of sort of disappointment, personal disappointment, where I felt like I worked 25 years for ever closer union, and 25 years I believed in ever closer union, but now it's gone. It's really gone. And the day I flew home, I have told the story to some journalists who are here in the room. But the day I flew home, and I had a friend of mine, and we had two or three glasses of red wine, and I don't know, we took this barcode, which is from Rem Koolhaas. And you know the story that Rem Koolhaas painted this sort of barcode with the flags to have it on the euro notes. Yeah, and whoever is all young enough to remember the Gulden, which were sort of very colorful monopoly money, but not seriously enough for the Germans, yeah, this color wonderful Gulden sort of thing. So we needed the German stability, so bridges, yeah, and this is why the euro notes have bridges and not this. And Rem Koolhaas was, say, pissed off, and he put this into open space, copyright free in the internet, so everybody can download this. And I downloaded this on the evening, in that April evening, and I felt like political union, whatever. The wording of republic flew to my mind, and this became a postcard. And in the midst of the euro crisis, my friend who designed it gave me 500 postcards, and I had these postcards always with me, and I distributed them in, you know, in subways and in restaurants table, always with these postcards, with no intention other than when I observed people looking at the postcards, everybody would go, oh, is this cute? Oh, where am I? Oh, look, the Greeks are there. Ah, is that Austria? Or is that, you know, where the Dutch sort of thing, yeah? And then I realized that in a way I had created an emotional opening, Rem Koolhaas, but me using the black coat with the Republican sort of thing, yeah? But an emotional opening to think differently about Europe, to just create the space to think differently. And what is interesting, and now I'm 6 years behind, and now I have, say, academic research, yeah, because I did a study on what you could call the semantisches Differential, which is a linguistic method to test out the resonance board of words, because words do matter. Yeah, it's like Johannes Evangelium, am Anfang war das Wort, yeah, or François Dolto, tout est langue, everything. Words do matter, and it is different to say European Republic or United States of Europe. Why? Because most people intuitively understand that the Republic has something to do with them, and it places them in the midst of sovereignty and in the midst and in charge of the political system. And United States of Europe, you can go on, sort of, it's these states out there who need to do the European integration, and maybe they do integration or maybe they don't do integration, but it's the sort of states. And it brings you back to the wording of Jean Monnet, for whom Max Kronstam worked, which is that Europe, nous ne coalisons pas des États, mais nous unissons des gens. Europe is not about integrating states, but it is about uniting people. And uniting people is a different paradigm than integrating states. You can integrate states into a market and into a currency, but then you have not necessarily united the people, and that's basically the state of the art we are in. We do have full integration in market space and in the currency space, but we do not have the unification of the people. Why? Because for the moment we are living in a legal space, der europäische Rechtsraum, EU, legal community. And in that legal community, three of the four freedoms are basically equal in front of the law, which is services, goods, and capital. They all, say, are under the umbrella of the legal community of the EU. But the people, which are us, which are the sovereign of the system, we are not equal in front of the law, because you, as Dutch citizens, you are in a different law space than me, as a German citizen, in terms of taxation, in terms of social rights, which means that, for instance, in the euro crisis, we go into competition of citizens within the same polity which we want to be a political project. But the thing is that citizens do not compete. Markets do compete. Citizens don't compete. So as long as we are competing through legal things in terms of citizenship, we cannot be in one political union. We cannot be in one European democracy. But if you say European Republic, it means one thing. Because the definition of republic in the definition of Cicero is jus equium, equal rights. So those citizens who agree upon the same rights to be equal in front of the law, those build a republic. And the notion is that in this definition of Cicero, there's no such thing than ethnic or culture. Those who agree to be equal in front of the law form a republic. That is Cicero. And so the idea was just that we could take this for the European sort of thinking, because if we were 500 European citizens, from whatever, Hungarian, Dutch, Finnish, and so on and so forth, origins, the moment we decide to be equal in front of the law, meaning the stuff which concerns us, which is taxation, which is social rights, we could finally have a democracy which would be worth its name. So let's detail this a little bit, because what we have now in the European Union is what we call sui generis. Everybody who's studying European studies has this in the textbooks, that the EU is a system sui generis. And sui generis is really a nice invention to not need to think about what you have created. Yeah, because sui generis means basically self-explicative. So we have done it like this, and it does not need no explanation. That's basically what sui generis says. The thing is that what we have built is totally legal, because we did the Maastricht Treaty, and then Amsterdam Treaty, and then Nizza Treaty, and Constitution, and Lisbon, and so on and so forth. So it's legal, but the question of today is it legitimate? Is it legitimate? Is there an input legitimacy from the people as a sovereign of the system? And this is basically most of the political talk we have today, be that Macron, the reconstruction of the European Parliament, be this all the proposals from Varoufakis, from whoever you want, but they all touch the decisive question: who decides in the European Union? Quid governandum? It's the oldest question of political science: who decides? And in the Max Weberian sense, which is who has the legitimate monopoly of power, this question is not answered in the European Union. And we see that every day when we talk about Europe. For instance, take the refugee question. We have a distribution key. The European Council decided a refugee key. Orban, as a head of state, Hungary, does not want to take 963 refugees. So there's a court ruling now that obviously Hungary needs to take the 963. We're not going to sanction. We're not going to take or to put 963 refugees in a bus and put them over the Hungarian border. We're not doing this. But what it means in essence is that we don't have sanctioning power for what is our law, because we should be able to sanction decisions and judgments of the European Court. And as long as we don't have sanctioning power, and we have not responded to the question who has the legitimate monopoly of power in the Weberian sense in the European Union. The thing is that neither the EU nor the nation state holds it, that monopoly, but us as the citizens. That's basically the idea of the republic, and I will come back to this. But for the moment, we are stuck in a system in which we have a commission, which is said to be guardian of the treaty, although that should be the role of an institutional court, of a European court. We do have a parliament, which is nice to have, and it's good that we have that parliament. I'm not in denial, and it's good that the parliament can do glyphosate decisions and so, but it's not a parliament that has a legal initiative. So it's not a parliament which is granted sort of full democratic tools. It's not a parliament one person, one vote, because we have weighted votes in the European Parliament. And we do have a council which overrides every decision that is happening in opaque, intransparent meetings overnight. And then, and this is sort of the governance is ownership for everybody, but responsibility for none, when that happens, nobody is responsible. Every head of state comes out and says, was not me, was him. Yeah. So, I think that the Colin Crouch paradigm, post-democracy, which is that you can always vote but you have no choice, is pretty much true for the European Union. That was what the Greeks experienced. They could always vote, they could go for a referendum, they could do OXI, they always got the memorandum of understanding. Yeah, so there is a real sort of flaw of European democracy. And it led to what? It basically led to the fact that people lost interest, support, aim of the European Union, and that's what we are dealing with now. There's no relation between us as the citizens deciding in the system, and people lost interest, people lost Boris Johnson. I am not in control. So Brexit. The problem is, he is right. He is not in control in the sense of a full-fledged parliamentarization of the system. I'm not saying the answer is Brexit, at the opposite, but perhaps the answer is parliamentarization of the system, so as to go to Boris Johnson and say, sure, you are in control. We do have bicameralization, two chambers, and so on and so forth. So what we have created, that is a sentence from Thomas Piketty, who perhaps you know. He had an interview in Spiegel recently and said, we have created a monster, so I brought you a monster. And it's pretty interesting to see that this sort of Gramsci quotation, when the old world cannot die and the new world is not born, we are living in the times of the monster, seems to be interregnum, it's the interregnum sort of thing of Gramsci, seems to be pretty much what we feel like we are experiencing. I guess most of the people who are into politics have the feeling that something is happening, something is changing, and that it's pretty much this. Something is dying, And we don't want this because we hold to it, you know, let go is not an easy exercise. The new is not there. How do we manage the transition? I give you another quote from Stefan Zweig in German first, and I will try to translate. But Stefan Zweig said, es ist den Zeitgenossen nicht, es ist den Zeitgenossen nicht vorbehalten zu verstehen, in welcher historischen Periode sie leben. Contemporaries cannot understand in which historical moment they are in. So we can say Weimar Republic, that was 1918 to 1933, opening, closure, historical epoche. Yeah? So we are in whatever epoche which is lasting since, say, Treaty of Maastricht, 92, ever closer union. We have the feeling that this is sort of not working. Yeah, something is closing, something new is in the air, but the transition is not yet done. And it's tough, yeah? We know also from history that these moments of transitions are not easy ones. It makes us fear. And so, and that is also state-of-the-art social science, in such states of sort of crisis sentiment, what collectivities do is they go in regression back to the last level of comfort zone. So this national sort of talk we have is that in our memories we have, as long as we are a little bit older than, say, 15, we have memories that in the good old world, sort of the old Federal Republic, the old Netherlands, and so, the sort of cozy nation state was okay, provided us with jobs and so. And so we see that the transitions is there. It doesn't help us. We don't know where we go. It makes a lot of fear. And it's a natural sort of behavior that you go back in regression to the last level of your comfort zone where you had the feeling that things were okay. And by doing so, obviously, you are totally in denial that first things were never okay, that even in the Bundesrepublik Deutschland, you had inflation, whatever. Yeah, you understand my point. The nostalgia always takes over that there was something, a sort of okay comfort zone. But talking about what is really happening and going back to the blame game of how do we go through the crisis and how we can come out in one single democracy, because one of the biggest problem of the current crisis and what we make out of it seems to be that we are not ready or not happy or not willing or perhaps both to have a similar understanding of what the crisis was. That is, again, the blame game. Yeah, the Greeks feel like it was the German austerity policy. The Germans feel it was the lazy Greeks. So we have very, very different analysis in socioeconomic terms what led us to the crisis. And I think what is happening is that we were in a period where everybody was benefiting from the flaws of the system, which were good for them. The South did a reckless, a spending party because there was so much lending from the North. So the South overspent, but the North overlent, reckless lending. Yeah. So basically, we are doing. Everybody used the the niches of the system for its own benefit. Yeah. But now you're blaming the other one for the mistake that the other one did. So that's the North-South divide. Yeah, the North is convinced that we got it right. The North is you in that case, with the Germans, with the Finns, with, you know, all these people who feel like not too much money for the South because these people cannot deal with money. And the South has the same reproaches to us. And we are, I don't know here, I guess here, sir, it's a Catholic university, but there is that one finger thing, yeah, one and three back sort of thing. And I think that's what's happening in the Euro crisis. Everybody is just seeing the mistake of the other nation and not seeing the big mistakes that the nation, I'm speaking for Germany here, yeah, but at least three fingers which point to Germany, which Germany systematically overlooks when it comes to the reasons of the Euro crisis. But here's the thing, if we were to reason in what a country does and so, and who is benefiting or losing out from the Eurozone thing, the first evidence to see is that what divides us today is not national borders in terms of socioeconomic underpinnings. What divides us today, and this is the chart, if you are violet, you are good. If you're not violet, you are less good. That's the very easy reading of the chart. But what it tells you is Eastern Germany is not good and is not export champion. The real dividing line is south, north, and rural and urban. You can be Barcelona, you can be Madrid, you can even be Athens, you are well. If you're in the middle of Europe, you're well. If you're in the periphery, you are not well. And that independently of whether you are northern Finland or whether you are southern Italy, it's a center-periphery rural-urban divide. And it has nothing to do with national borders. And the problem is that all our EU policies, that's, by the way, a chart from the German Industrial Industry Association, so it's not a Marxist sort of whatever lefty chart, but it's the basic data from industry clusters of BDE, German industries. And if we have to cope with that problem, then we should perhaps stop framing policies in the EU framework along national borders, because that's still what we do in the way we treat the budget, in the way we distribute the budget, in the way we allocate money through the EU system. It's all still along national borders. The problem is that this border thing has a political impact, and it goes, I know, not in a straight one-to-one ratio, but the rural-urban divide means to a very large extent, these are the data for France, but you could take Austria, you could take the Netherlands, you could take Denmark, the two Finns, and it's sort of true for most of the countries, that rural means unemployed, means populist vote. Not one-to-one. I know that there are also very wealthy little areas like, say, the 16e arrondissement in Paris, where the vote of Front National is interestingly high, and in Hamburg, Blankenese, where you wouldn't expect the modernization losers, the vote of AfD is interestingly high, so there are other motives to look for. But in essence, you have a very strong correlation between rural, unemployed, modernization losers, vote for national populist parties. And it has something to do with the way we manage EU policies. Why? Because the EU is not a state, because it's not a state, it has no lending capacity, because it has no lending capacity, it cannot do investments, because it cannot do investments, nobody is building an internet in areas where the population is gone. And when there's no internet, then ever more people leave the area, because then you cannot build a business. Yeah. So there is a vicious cycle, and it's an inbuilt vicious circle in the way we frame and we shape the European policies, because we cannot go for the set of basic investment, because what is the investment side, it falls sort of the, say, the internet roaming thing falls between the nation state level, which is no longer sort of responsible, and the EU, which is not yet responsible. If you look at the digital agenda, it's one of these super fancy papers of the European Union. We need to build a digital union. Yeah, it's a super cool goal. The only thing is that each member state is responsible for doing it. Yeah, and that is how we end up like this. So now some little reflections, state, republic, some points, what I feel like the period we are in and what perhaps is helpful if we want to analyze where we should need to go. This is what, I guess you know, the front of the very famous book of Hobbes, Leviathan. And the interesting thing is, if you can see it from behind, is the moment that you create the state, the people, yeah, the fiction of the people transferring the sovereignty to the state. That's them, that moment, yeah. The little feminist component is that the state is obviously male and powerful. But leaving this aside, the thing is, the moment the people sort of climb into the state for that moment of contract, yeah, the town is empty. And what Hobbes wanted to tell us with this is that there is a difference between population and people. Or in other words, there's no such thing than a people. A people is always a construct. It's a construct of a given moment of, you know, like Spinoza, the nature knows no people. But the people is a sort of notion that we invented for the moment to construct the state. But when we go to moments like the referendum, where now the Brits are running around, the people have spoken, no, the population has spoken. The problem with referendum is who you ask is always the population. The people is the moment of a fiction in which a certain entity of people is giving that state. But what I mean here is, in the referendum, for instance, let's say this British, the people has spoken, the problem is that if this people is reversing opinion, the people cannot withdraw. We invented representative democracy to make different choices at another moment in time. Because if the people has spoken and the people has no representation, the people cannot be abandoned, the people cannot be changed, the people cannot be withdrawn. It cannot be, you understand my point, a parliament, you can outvote, different parliament, different policy. So the Brits are locked into a confusion between people and population, which is basically the confusion which lies at the origin of every referendum. And this is why it's so dangerous. Yeah, and this is why Mrs. May can no longer move out, because like Bertolt Brecht say, ich kann mir kein anderes Volk wählen. Yeah. But that was basically the wisdom of the ancient writers, why we invented representative democracy, and I think we should stick to it. So if you want to go deeper into that theoretical argument, I recommend that book of Agamben, who had this book, Stasis, Der Bürgerkrieg als politisches Paradigm. And I want to relate that book to basically what is happening now, because the essential point of Agamben's book is with which you could argue that the situation Europe is in today is basically the situation of a civil war in the terms of the theory of this. Why? Because that people who is climbing into that state and wants one thing, that is gone. Today, it's not so easy to say who's the British people, those who voted Brexit or those who voted against. It's not so easy to say who are the French today, those who are with Macron, those who are with Marine Le Pen. Not so easy to say who are the Germans, the AfD, Pegida, or Pulse of Europe. Who are the Dutch people? Yeah, and so the state we are in is basically that we are having crowd here, crowd there, most of the time, crowds who can no longer reconciliate. This is why the AfD is basically, you know, kept out of parliamentarian things, and you don't like Geert Wilders so much, and they're always, you know, Hofer, Van der Bellen. So it's splitting people into two pieces. That is the message. And if you apply this Stasis paradigm, what is happening is that if the people in that sort of fiction of a transferation of a state is breaking apart into crowds, and these crowds do no longer find ways of reconciliation, you are basically in the erosion of a democracy or a monarchy, whatever, and you need to reconstitute a different people or state. Yeah. So my argument is that if we take that paradigm, you could argue that perhaps for the first time in Europe, we are in a period of time where politics tops nation, meaning that I feel closer to any given Pole who is demonstrating against the peace government than I feel close as a German to the people with Pegida. So if that is the thing that we could say today, then perhaps we are in such a moment in which the people, in the way we understood the people of yesterday's nation states, are breaking apart, and that would give us, at least in theory, theoretical space to rebuild a nation or republic in the space along political dividing lines and not along dividing lines which come from basically or national origin. So I just brought this because before the republic there is the revolution. I just wanted also to do, you know, revolution, revolvere. In that sense, I use the word revolvere, basically back to the roots. And revolvere, like a revolver, who's always, you know, the if you tuck, tuck, tuck six times, you go to the same hole, is basically going back to the origins. That is also the sense of revolvere. And there is, I mean, don't get me wrong, I do not want to call for a revolution. I just wanted to link the word of revolution to republic, because the first revolution, then republic. But I also wanted to strengthen that it is a process of revolvere, which is think about what is at the origins of sovereignty, and that is the moment of the people. So here you go. I brought you another image of Mrs. Republic. She is hanging, this is from Mr. Dumier, she's hanging in Louvre, it's painted in 1848. And the interesting sort of imago is that the Republic feeds the people, the citizens. She has a citizen at each breast. And I think that's a very different imago than the single market. The single market does not care for citizens, but probably this explains to a large extent why Republic has an emotional good resonance board with citizens, because intuitively you understand that republic is res publica, is the common good, is for you. By the way, the English translation of republic is commonwealth. Not in the sense of commonwealths like British Empire, but commonwealths, shared wealth. Yeah? And we are hanging around with this for 2,000 years. Platon, Aristotle, Cicero, Kant, Rousseau, everybody was republic. Yeah? Democracy, I mean, if you read Aristotle, democracy is nothing. Don't go for majority rules. Republic is has a very different moral binding to the law. I mean, in political theory, the republic is a very different thing than a democracy. Yeah? So obviously we are having this for 2,000 years sort of in our DNA, yeah, and we know how to, so there is an imago, and perhaps the idea is to activate this for Europe. If we were to do so, we could understand that Europe is whole, a woman, by the way, a beautiful one. This is the first map of Mrs. Europe painted in I think 1586. The interesting thing is it came after Luther and after the religious wars, when Europe had the Christianity breaking into Protestant and Catholic, and you needed Res Publica Europaea as one imago that Europe is entire, is whole. And people who could not read maps by then, they could not read anyway, but they always went for sort of symbols. And this is a symbol for basically der Garten Eden in the Bible, and the Donau, the Danube, is the Aorta, sort of der Mutterfluss. And it has a very organic sort of illusion that Europe is a woman, it's beautiful, it's pretty, it's whole. And all the people, you can even have a libidinous explanation, but all the people are in Mrs. Europe, yeah? So you have the Greeks and the French and everybody is in there, but everybody has an organic space and place. Yeah, that's a very different thing than sort of Brexit, I can go out, but you have an, everybody has an organic space, so everybody needs to be in Europe so as Europe to function. If we move from there, you could say, if that is the thing, we need a republic as 500 million European citizens, we want Europe to be whole, we want that to be one democracy, one market, one currency, one democracy. I think the intelligent question is, what could be... if we then need full parliamentarization and a bicameral system, and we want to be one person, one vote in the first chamber, we would need a second chamber. And the real question, which is debated in current policy terms, is what could be that second chamber? Does this need to be the nation-state representations as of today with big Germany and small Malta? Or can we find more intelligent sort of provinces or regions so as to divide the European continent in, say, logical, more or less logical regions, provinces, and so on and so forth. So this is just a map to say that Europe is bigger than the nation-state, and there are many other divisions possible. The regional Europe is in the literature a big theme coming up every now and then. There's a lot of literature that shows you, or even scientific analysis, that people feel most happy in political entities, which is between 8 and 15 million people. Perhaps that's why the Netherlands are so happy country. In entities between 8 and 15 million, political science says it's sort of optimal governance size. Why? People do not feel governed by Moscow, by Berlin, by Washington, sort of fremdregiert. Yeah? And the explanation is that clientelism functions. So whatever you think about clientelism, but what it means is in entities between 8 and 15 millions, people feel like if things go not well for you, you have a cousin in the government that you can call. And whether you have a cousin in the government or you don't, doesn't matter. As long as you believe you have a cousin in government, then it's good and you do not feel fremdregiert. Yeah? So it would speak for dividing Europe in more or less, whatever, 50, 55, 60 entities. Yeah, and we are, by the way, in the midst of that historical process. There is Scotland, there is Bavaria, there is Tyrol, there is Wallonie, CETA agreements, there is Limburg, I don't know. But you had seven, I mean, so the seven Dutch republics, yeah, in the 17th century, there you also have sort of living memories, not living, perhaps dead memories, but reactivable memories of the republic. But whatever, yeah. If you say that Tyrol today is an entity which is divided by an Austrian-Italian border, that Baskenland is an entity which is divided by a Franco-Spanish border, and so on and so forth, you could arguably make the case that what is the nation-state in the current definition as constitutive elements of the European Union today is really very random. Yeah. For instance, Saarland, if you just take Saarland, Saarland had in 55 a referendum whether they want to belong to France or whether they belong to Germany or whether they wanted to be independent. They choose Germany and now they're a poor part of Germany. Had they chosen independence, we would believe today that Saarland is a nation. Yeah. That's basically how it goes with Kosovo. Yeah. So all this to say that what we define as a nation is more or less choice. Yeah. And to just make that argument up front, nation has not much to do with cultural identity, but what is a nation beyond political choice is always who is in one legal entity. And that is where the definition of republic and nation are sort of merging. I come to this, but the moment you understand that the nation, what makes a nation is those who are in one legal framework, then you have a very different access to how we could go into a process of, say, nation building of Europe, if we want so, or you call it republic. I prefer republic because nation is a little bit trompe. So, all this to reason to say, if we want one market, one currency, one democracy, and I do still think we should go for that, because I am arguing that if we don't do, we probably lose the currency and the market. And the Brexit is the first step into that. And the Brits are experiencing what it means to lose the market. It means basically losing 10% of GDP. We do not want this. So two choices. Either we are going for completion, which is one market, one currency, one democracy. As European citizens, we build finally that republic around the market and the currency. Or perhaps we are losing it again. Or even worse, we are staying with a market and a currency in an area of non-democracy. And then we should question whether we want this. I mean, whether we eternally want to be under the decision-making of an EU Council, which is at least problematic in sense of legitimacy, or whether we want to overcome this. If we were to overcome this, I think it's important to understand that it's an emancipatory process, a little bit like, you know, French Revolution was equality beyond classes. Suffragettes, very current theme, yeah, 100 years of women's rights, was political equality beyond gender. The Martin Luther King was political equality, legal equality beyond race. And now we should strive for political equality beyond nationality. That is basically the emancipatory claim that that the European Republic would have. And for those who have seen the movie, I don't know whether the movie runs in the Netherlands, there's a super film about suffragettes. And the film tells you that legal equality doesn't fall from the sky. You claim for it and then hopefully you get it, but if you don't claim for, nobody grants it to you. Huh? In other words, the men wouldn't give the right to vote freely to the women 100 years ago. So the goal would be, for one democracy, we need electoral equality, fiscal policy and equal access to social rights, which is just one person, one vote, and to end all these very weird stories. One weird story is that I know a German who was married to a Dutch. The man died, she moved back from Amsterdam to Germany, and now she doesn't get widow allocation. Why? Because the Germans say she was married to a Dutch, and the Dutch say she's now living in Germany. Yeah, there are endless stories of this, where citizens basically pay the bill that we are the only element of the four freedoms which is not under the same sort of legal space, whereas capital, finances, and capital, Dienstleist services if we were to do so, one concept of, why is this not building up? Is it here? Strange. Normally there are three pillars. Sorry, don't know why this is not working. You imagine there is a sort of house of representation with citizens, which is the parliament, one person, one vote. On the other hand, you could imagine a senate. Say we have 50 regions in Europe, and these regions send two senators, like in the US, with the difference that a senator is not the governor, so it would empower the regions. We are, I think one of the features of our time is you want more identity, you want more regional sort of cozy politics. So there should be a thinking how we can basically empower the regions in the political system of the European Union and give to the people what they want, a strong Europe in the world on the one hand, but also a very regional sort of power in a political system. So that would be the idea. I'm still figuring out why this is not working. But then the third pillar is evidently you could vote the European president directly, which is not utopian. This is in most of the party programs we are dealing with today, that people are wanting the direct election of a European parliament president. The only question is, what is that president then? Is he more a French president or more a German president? So the question of which power would he have is obviously an important one. But here's the thing. If we are striving for full parliamentarization of the political system of Europe, then the question is not to build a super state in the sense of centralization. The question is about parliamentarization and division of power. And having division of power and having parliamentarization does not mean or has nothing to do with centralization. This is always the argument which comes from the so nationalist. You want to have a, you know, I'm losing my identity, it's a super state, it's about centralization and Brussels needs to decide everything. No, I come from the European Republic of Germany. Yeah, Berlin does not decide on everything. There's Nordrhein-Westphalia, it's a very strong state, and we have very different policies, but we have one thing in the Federal Republic of Germany, is that me as a German, I'm equal in law with my Bavarian fellows, independently of what Seehofer does. At the end of the day, me and the Bavarian, we all get hearts four if we fail in life. And that is essentially what distinguishes me from you, because I feel much closer to that area because I'm born close to Venlo, and I feel very much at home here and much more at home than in Bavaria. But what makes me a German is not my culture, my identity as a Rhinelander. What makes me being a German together with the Bavarian is that I'm in one legal entity with him and not with you. So now two little definitions and then I'm done for what a nation is. I just stumbled over this really, really good book, which interestingly has just been republished. It's a book of the 1920s of a French social law called Marcel Mauss, Die Nation oder der Sinn für Soziale. And interestingly enough, the book has just been re-edited in 2017, last year, in German at least. And Mauss makes a very strong argument for a sentence which is... die Nation macht die Rasse und nicht die Rasse die Nation. Obviously, that's the language of the 30s, but it's basically meaning the nation makes the race and not the race the nation, which is that those who enter a legal community start to understand themselves as a nation and then build the identity of being a single race. And from there, you go for overshooting nationalism and so on and so forth. But the nation makes a race and not the race the nation, which is the argument of those who argue that you need to be a sort of ethnically clean race to form a nation. And what it is that that book has a very strong accent that what makes a nation is a legal argument. And he says that what makes a nation is institutionalized solidarity. And I really like that definition, that a nation is institutionalized solidarity. Because if you go back to the Greek crisis or the Euro crisis, if we had had institutionalized solidarity in the sense that we would all have been in the same legal space as European citizens, we would have not had the nasty chauvinist discussions that the Greeks are lazy and the Germans are hardworking and whatever. Because all these sort of games which we had, sort of the Germans go to retirement at age 67 and the Greeks are lazy with 50, fine, if you are institutionalized solidarity in the same legal framework, we would need to decide in a European Parliament what is our retirement age. No more distinction through nationality, institutionalized solidarity, it would make us a nation and we would stop the chauvinist sort of gambles that we had in this area. The second definition I stumbled about, it's very interesting because Theodor Schieder, to not get that wrong, he was a Nazi and then a very conservative sort of historian. And it's interesting that he... in a speech in 63, yeah, defined what is a nation, it's a union of citizens and not language, ethnicity or culture. And if you apply, I mean, 63, very forward-thinking in a way, but if you apply these definitions, say, for the Brexit case, yeah, where we now have all these problems with the Europeans living in the UK, but also with the British living here on the continent, not figuring out sort of, you know, retirement, and are they going back to third state level? I mean, there are huge, huge questions at stake for the youngsters in the UK. The problem is that the Maastricht Treaty promised us to be union of states and union of citizens, which is that definition. And we never materialized union of citizens, at least not in the sense of legal underpinning. We are sort of European citizens because we like each other, because we are all living in the legal space, which guarantees that our markets and currencies are equal, but not us. So in a way, the cheatment or the little betrayal of the Maastricht Treaty is that the Maastricht Treaty never materialized that notion of union of citizenships. And if we were to have it today, then in theory, it would be quite of egal whether the UK as a country leave the European Union, because those who have status of European citizenship would simply remain members or citizens of the European Republic. So with that, I'm at the end. I think that Macron is sort of going in that direction, because if he's claiming now for one finance minister, restructuring the European Parliament, Eurozone budget, and so, it's basically opening a gate to that thinking. I hope so. I also feel like La République en Marche, he should just add La République Européenne en Marche, and that would be nearly there. I'm a little bit unhappy that my country is blocking everything that Macron is doing this day, but your country isn't any better, because you have probably heard about this letter of the aid, which is, oh, Schäuble is gone, we need to speak up ourselves. So it's probably not the nice development here. But if we were to go with Schieder and with Marcel Mauss and with Macron, we probably had a chance to achieve some, at some point in history, the European Republic. And I would be happy if I convinced you that we should do this. Many thanks.
Maybe the first question, you said at some point of time this will be created, it must be created. Do you have a plan when this is going to happen?
Well, in the book I gave a date, 9th of May 2045. It feels like an obvious date to create a European Republic 100 years after the disaster we had last century. To give the young generation 25 years time to basically do it. But it's interesting that as much as we can look into the past, say 89 is a very present moment for most people, what happened in 89, yeah? And then you can measure how much the world changed between 89 and today. But if you say 45, we live in the European Republic, most people tell me, oh, I'm really crazy, right? And that's the reproach I'm living under, that I'm totally utopian. But I want to point to the fact that if we can measure 25 years backwards and we can assess how much changed, we should be able to accept that within the next 25 years, chances are really high that something will really change. So now, I don't have a concrete plan how to go there. But I wrote the book a little bit with this very beautiful quote of Derrida, yeah. It's impossible but necessary. Yeah, I'm convinced that history is a little bit like John Lennon gave us, sort of life is happening while you are making plans about it, right? History is happening while we are trying to plan it. Yeah. So the European Republic, if ever we go there, will not be decided at an EU Council meeting, and it will not be signed by Macron and by Merkel and by Reuters. This does not mean that it will not take place, because sometimes history just does things we do not know before. Yeah, on 10th of September 2001, nobody would have known that we can bring down a gold system with three knives. And on the 8th of November 89, nobody would know that the German unification would just take place. So my perception of history is that there are always moments when the doors of history are open, like the quote of Stefan Zweig. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we should have a plan what happens when the doors are going open. Yeah. So I'm not calling for a revolution. I don't have a plan. We do this. So I think what best we can do is really have a clear idea and a plan that should come through the door when Hegel's Weltgeist is opening that door. What I mean is that the currency union was the Werner Plan, and it was drafted in 1970. And Werner was as much told to be completely sort of nuts when he wrote that currency union plan. And then we needed to wait basically 22 years for the currency union to come through the door of history. And the triggering moment was obviously German unification, and then we did the Maastricht Treaty, which are a history of the same second of history, 89-92, right? Mm-hmm. So if I try to design the Republic, it's in the ambition to have a real idea what we do the day after X, yeah, which is the moment when something will happen, that we should have an opportunity to say, now, Now we do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Another question was, to whom are you talking? Because wouldn't you think that the whole project is in a way an elitist thing? The elites in Europe have always been cosmopolitan, and they still are. Here is a Dutch guy and a German professor talking in English for a Dutch audience. But we are not the victims of modernization. We profit from modernization. You were talking about the victims of modernization, the victims of globalization. You had these charts of the French elections. We've just had Italian elections, which were much better. Who are you addressing? Isn't this very much an elite project?
Okay, there are a couple of elements of an answer. Yes. Say upfront, it is an elite project, mm-hmm. but politics always was an elite project. So I'm not against elites, by the way. I'm very happy that elites run a state. Mm-hmm. The condition is that they run it well for the citizens. Mm-hmm. So what was the mistake of the last years was not that the elites were running a state, but that they fed the system into mm-hmm. their own pocket. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And because I need to stay a little mm-hmm. bit there, yeah, because I think that's the problem of today. In the sense that now, because we screwed up the system, everybody's about participation and plebiscite and Brexit, and we know where we get there, yeah? So I feel like the fact that the system has been screwed up by elites, the answer is not necessarily that now everybody needs to decide. The answer is perhaps that we get different elites, and elites who care for the Republic in the sense of commonwealth, mm-hmm. yeah? Which mm-hmm. is the thing which escaped us, yeah? So I'm not. There is a very interesting video clip. You can Google this, which is an artist who, and it explains this, you know, participation all over the place sort of thing. And he puts five people around eine Töpferscheibe, pottery mm-hmm. thing, yeah. And you can 5 minutes, and you can see that five people cannot do a bowl. Just doesn't work. Mm-hmm. But if the task is we need a bowl so to drink, it's better that somebody does the bowl mm-hmm. and not five people participating in doing the bowl. The thing is that the one who has the bowl needs to get it round that everybody drinks and not keep the bowl for himself and say, if you're not having the bowl, then you are mm-hmm. failing. Yeah, which was the mm-hmm. sort of discourse we had. So that to elites. So in that sense, I'm not anti-elite. Yeah? Mm-hmm. There's mm-hmm. a different mm-hmm. moral binding for what policy should be. But now, there is another element to whom I'm addressing. And the funny thing is that, and honestly, I wouldn't think it would end up that way. I first would never think that the book would be translated or would be sort of, it was a certain success in Germany. So basically, I spent 2 years traveling Lübeck, Freiburg, Dresden, Köln, North, whatever. There are towns in Germany, I wouldn't know that they exist, but I went with the Republic. The interesting thing is that citizens are not the problem. Citizens are not the problem. I can talk to österreichischen Gemeinderäten in little Winzer towns, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. wine towns. You tell citizens you want to be equal in front of the law, you want a European unemployment scheme. Mm-hmm. Normally, I get 500, you know, 500, 300, 150 people, whatever, in Bavaria, die Bayerischen Landfrauen. Nobody is yelling at me. Even in Dresden, yeah. It was very interesting. I was very fearful to be in Dresden because Pegida was outside and the room was there, and I felt like probably the room is filled with Pegida people and I will be thrown eggs at. I had more or less standing ovations in Dresden for saying more or less the same thing I said to you. My problem is not the citizens. My problem is really political elites. When I'm talking with Jens Spahn on a panel in Berlin, then he is basically mm-hmm. throwing me out of the window. Yeah, I'm completely utopian and whatever. So I was, for instance, with Per Steinbrück in Hamburg, a huge room, yeah? And then Steinbrück would go against me. This utopian costs too much money, blah, blah, blah.
Costs too much money, yeah.
And I had a full room of basically 500 more or less young people who were mm-hmm. telling mm-hmm. Steinbrück to shut up. So the interesting dynamic is, if I have enemies in that discourse, it's not the people.
But why then do these people? I mean, I just mentioned the Italian election, the last series of elections in Europe, you know, fatal elections in a way, where you have now the parties that were against it had an anti-Europe rhetoric won, and they are now unable to form a government. So it seems these people you talk about do elect people that use this anti-European rhetoric. So who I mean, maybe your question, who is this people actually?
Okay, yeah. I think obviously I have been living in a German in a pretty European, because I'm traveling really a lot, but still my first focus is Germany, yeah. Mm. And obviously Germany has gone very well through the crisis, like the Netherlands have. And so this sort of complete, how would you say, diese Vollnis, what is Vollnis, you know, perished political systems, verfault, is not yet in Germany. Like you have this in Italy, or you have it in Poland, or you have it in Hungary. So Hungary is really bad, but... What is bad about these sort of where's the people? I think there is a clear, and yes, I agree with you that some countries, it's a little bit like lakes, like, you know, these lakes who are missing oxygen beyond a certain level, beyond sort of a huge threat, yeah, which is attacked of the sea will... Der See fällt. Even if you get oxygen from the external, because there's a systemic effect that a rotten system needs to totally rotten, and then out of the rotten things there's new life. But if it's sort of a third rotten, even if you get oxygen from the outside, you don't save the system. And so yes, there's a fair point to say whether for, say, Poland or Hungary or Italy, who have been super harmed by the euro crisis, for various, not the euro crisis, but the European crisis at large, whether it's sort of too late. Let's distinguish the southern and the eastern countries when we talk about populists. Obviously, Italy has its own problem. I do not want to downtalk the problems we all know from Italy, Mezzogiorno and tax evasion, blah, but had many additional problems through the way we fixed the euro crisis. So Italy has a perverted political scenery since many years, and Berlusconi could safely play on this. If you now say, look at Cinque Stelle is, in essence, anti-elite, but not necessarily anti-European. And just to say that one, but anti-elitism is not a bad thing. Woodstock was nothing else than fair anti-elitism, and rightly so. It changed the system for the better. The problem with populism is not the anti-elitist side. The problem is the anti-pluralist side, is we are the people. And then the others are not people, like AfD people yelling, I'm the people. And then, you know, when I was in Dresden on the marketplace and they were yelling, wir sind das Volk und wir wissen das, I said, you know, your problem is I'm also the people. And it's the anti-pluralist argument which doesn't sell. Anti-elitism is good. So I would make a distinction between Lega Nord and Cinque Stelle, that the hope for Italy of today is they can get the Cinque Stelle people into the bath of, say, wouldn't call it mainstream policy, but they are, say, only anti-elitist, and rightly so, because there's a good reason to be anti-elitist in Italy. But Beppe Grillo started with water, free water, with environment, with anti-corruption. He had four or five things. And none of them at the beginning were anti-European. And the biggest single voting entity of Cinque Stelle is, believe it, educated women between 30 and 50. This is not old white man sort of populist rhetoric. So I do have hope that Gentiloni and Renzi can do something with Cinque Stelle, and that we get them back into whatever European thing. So yes, I'm with you that there are countries in which the, say, public discourse is more rotten than in others, and that we have leaving too much space to those sailing on this. And Italy is certainly one of these countries. By the way, Greek too, a little less. In the Eastern, to just make that point, Hungary and Poland, before Orban was a populist, Orban was a true European. Let's just remind this, he opened the border, 89, Hungary for the Germans and so. We promised then you come into the EU, 204, and we promised, that has been forgotten, you come into the Euro, 208. And because of our banking crisis, they didn't come into the Euro. But middle-class people in Hungary had bought houses on credits denominated in Swiss francs and in euro. And then they didn't come into the euro and they needed to pay back the credits in florint.
Yeah.
And the middle class in Hungary was pissed off disastrously.
Yeah.
And as a reaction, Orbán changed. And then Orbán was fed up with Europe. And what he then did, and the real question is, and I do not, you understand me well, I do not want to apologize Orbán for closing the Central European University, for closing newspapers, for closing the court and all these things. But if one thing he does, then Orbán does, by any standards, a sort of decent social policy because he's protecting the Hungarian citizens from the deregulation policies that, for instance, Europe is doing on telecommunication, gas, and so. So he keeps housing, cigarettes, gas cheap for his citizens. Do we want to blame him for that? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You have understood my point. Yeah, I'm not... Kaczynski is very interesting because if you reason in terms of what is he doing, then at least he's doing a fair social policy. It comes with a racist spin and an anti-feminist spin and anti-abortion and so, but Kaczynski is paying, or his people, raised, for instance, the fee for Kindergeld in Poland to in relation, the zloty euro relation, to the four times what a German woman gets. Yeah, and that means roughly 130 euros for a Polish woman for each kid. In an average salary country where if you have a decent sort of study, you earn at best 500, 700 euro a month. With three kids, you get 500 euros in whatever patelin in Lodz, in Warsaw. You're very fine when you're a woman with three kids. So that will change Polish society.
Mm-hmm.
But do we want to blame Kaczynski for paying women well when women give birth? But so there is a problem of we blame these populists, but perhaps the populist is a reaction to what we did to the Eastern Europeans before.
But so would you say, because it's an odd phenomenon, this fact that you had this definition of nation, where nation was not defined in terms of culture and language, which is the rhetoric of the populists. It's the nation in the sense of what culture, the tradition and culture and so on. But would you say that there are economic reasons behind it? Because it's a strange phenomenon. I remember in the 70s and 80s, we didn't have a nation. We didn't, in this country, for instance, where we really concerned, we were concerned with beating you guys with football, but that was about it. And so this whole appearance of the nation, and the nation not in your sense, but in the cultural, populist sense, would you say that there is an economic agenda behind that? Is that what you claim?
Obviously. I mean, Marine Le Pen did her campaign in the last presidential elections with one sentence. There are many YouTube clips with one sentence. Quand il n'aura plus la nation, qui s'occupera des pauvres? When there is no more nation, who cares for the poor?
Mm-hmm.
That's a fair question. So the answer is Europe cares for the social, or there will be no Europe, or the nation has to deal for the social. Mm-hmm. So Kaczynski is giving the answer to Marine Le Pen, which is if the Europe is not caring for the social, then me as a nation state, I need to do the social, which is national socialism. I, as a German, know what I'm talking about. Yeah. So the problem of us, say European cosmopolitan people, is we need to do that social thing. That's probably now that the system is getting it. That's why we had the Göteborg summit and the social problem. They are slowly getting there. Sort of Europe does the social or Europe will not be. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously there's a relation between the identity thing and the economic question, because if you cannot deliver on the social, then you can deliver on the identity.
Yeah.
And I think much of the discourse on identity, telling everybody your identity is more than your rights, has to do with the question, with many things first, because we are always having meta levels here, but it has much to do with basically European social democracy failing totally in holding social claims for citizens. And because they could no longer hold social claims and social improvement for many citizens and the modernization losers, what they were going to say is you get identities.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If you have read the book of Didier Eribon, Le Retour à Reims, the Returning to Reims, it's a very good book about Didier Eribon, the French sociologue. And he is living in Paris, left his family years way back, and when the father dies, goes back to Reims. And he sees his whole family. He's the only one studying, blah, blah, blah. All his brothers, sisters, cousins back in Reims, and everybody went straight from Parti Communiste to Front National. Yeah. Why? Class pride is gone. No more identity through class, Parti Communiste. So you need another identity. And if you can no longer be offered social uprisal, you are offered a flag. Mm-hmm. And that is what is happening for the modernization losers. And that's not the modernization losers. They are only the takers. The more interesting question is who fuels that?
Yeah, exactly.
Because it doesn't fall from the sky. Yeah, so there are people who have an interest in fueling this. And so we do not offer social uprisal, but we offer identity.
Yeah, but can you tell something about that agenda then? What is the agenda about the people who mobilize this? Because this is on the side of the losers, so to speak. But who's winning from, who's benefiting from this? What is the agenda behind this?
Do we know? I wouldn't pretend that I have sort of deep insights or sort of full-fledged investigative stories here. But some stories are obvious, I mean, Putin has an interest and he's financing the Front National. More interesting in Germany is that they're really wealthy private person who are funding all this nationalist sort of racist journals. I mean, I give you one concrete example to sort of where does it come from, there is a new German journal which is called Katto, Magazin für neue Sachlichkeit. It comes across, it's lying next to the Spiegel, you can buy it for whatever, €8, It looks like a super cool, super photoshooting, nice magazine, Zeitschrift für neue Sachlichkeit, First edition, second edition. In the two editions, no women writing. Very interesting. And then you go through who's writing, and the strategy advisor of Frauke Petri, for instance.
AfD,
Many aristocrats writing, But these journals are just lying next to Spiegel as if it's sort of the most normal. So somebody is financing that because it's not financed at the market. So what we can say is that there's probably interest in getting this stuff out and financed, and probably is people who have an interest in. You could make the, say, I wouldn't call it cynical argument, but if we reason in, say, actor theory and in interest theory, we have one market, one currency, one democracy. The one market had a huge economic driver, all our industries. They had a huge interest in getting a single market. We had a huge economic driver in getting one currency, the banks. The banks had a super interest in, by the way, in 95, I should tell you, but I was director for the Association of Monetary Union in 95. So with Hilmar Kopper and Agnelli, and so I would sit and do all these plans for monetary union back in the 90s. And I can tell you that what Agnelli, the old Agnelli, said in Italy, he picked the phone and, you know, I mean, so there are economic drivers behind political stories. Now, one market, one currency, one democracy. The question is, what is the economic driver behind one European democracy? The answer is democracy has no economic driver because it's cost intensive. It's just people behind. These people want things like an unemployment scheme, whatever they want, a basic income. Democracy is cost intensive. So who should have an interest in financing European democracy? And if you reason that way, you could make the argument, or at least the hypothesis, that those who were the drivers behind the one market and the one currency are now the drivers, say, for no European democracy, saying that they then automatically finance the opposite sort of argument of nationalism and so, but at least you could say that they have sort of no interest in European democracy. And you can model this with parties. If you take Christian Lindner, liberal FDP, he would do the whole campaigning of the last German elections with keine Transferunion. Keine Transferunion, So that is, I guess, some elements of an answer. First, why European democracy is not happening, but also to say that those who vote AfD are the betrayed person. The real question is, who are those who betray? And it's, you know, look in the history books, it would not be the first time, right? I mean, it was the German industries who felt like Hitler's a puppet, we have him under control, and
Gruppenthyssen,
whatever.